Good morning, Barry Bryson here. Thank you for joining me for another 5 good minutes with the Word. And today we're continuing our study of Psalm 119, our verse-by-verse study of Psalm 119. And we're up to the letter Lamed, the letter L. Who knew? K and then L and then M and N in the next 2 days. Because, of course, there's really only been one alphabet, and all other alphabets on earth are just a derivation of that first Phoenician alphabet. And so we should not be surprised that the Greek alphabet and the Hebrew alphabet have a lot in common with each other and a lot in common with English alphabet. So anyway, this section, and remember, each section is 8 verses long. Each section begins with the letter Lamed. And or each verse in this section will begin with the letter Lamed. And each section contains in it a celebration of God's word. And we'll use usually 6 or 7 of the 7 words used in this psalm for the word, for God's word. There are a few that have only 5. But nearly every verse of this psalm has something to say about God's word. It is also a cry for help. This young man is crying out, help me. And he'll say that in this section today. Interesting, because this section, verses 89 through 96, is quite cosmological in the way 1 John 1 or Colossians chapters 1 and 2 or Psalm 19 is cosmological. It's also a wisdom psalm in the way Psalm 90 is, in talking about our place in the cosmological order and what we need to learn from God. But in the middle of all this, literally in the middle of it, he says, I am yours, save me. So anyway, let's read verses 89 through 96. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Your faithfulness continues throughout all generations. You establish the earth and it stands. They stand this day according to your ordinances. For all things are your servants. If your law had not been my delight, then I would have perished in my affliction. I will never forget your precepts, for by them you've revived me. I am yours. Save me. I have sought your precepts. The wicked wait to destroy me. I shall diligently consider your testimonies. I have seen a limit to all perfection. Your commandment is exceedingly broad. That last verse is a little enigmatic, but I think I get the gist of what he's saying. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. It kind of recalls the first verse of Psalm 90. God is our dwelling place. God's word is settled in heaven. It also truly, truly connects with Colossians chapters 1 and 2 and 1 John chapter 1, in which we are reminded that God created the heavens and the earth, that God is in control of all things and designed all things. And as John reminds us, God's creative medium was his word. God spoke words and everything came into existence. He didn't use a magic wand or anything. He used words. His words were spoken and things happened. And he says this as well. Your words created the universe. Your words order the universe. The universe is established because of your words. It's an enormous concept for us to continue to consider as we think about him celebrating God's word. It's not just the ink on the page, but every word God has spoken, every word God has delivered. Because this is true, everything's your servant. There's that passage, and I forget the exact verse from Proverbs 16. I think it's verse 6. God has made everything for its time, even the wicked for the day of judgment. And I may be slightly misquoting that. But the whole notion is that since God is in control of everything, no one can thwart God's will. That means no matter what we do in our exercise of our own free will, we end up being servants of God's own will. He can do that because he's infinite, and he can, in an infinite number of ways, make sure his will is accomplished no matter what we decide to do in our exercise of free will. All of these concepts are behind the expression of this passage, but then it's so personal. If I hadn't taken joy in your word, I would have perished in my affliction. If he teaches us a lesson, this young man, in this passage, it is this. We don't have the control we want over those who will make our lives difficult or even make our lives unbearable. And God may or may not intervene in the details of our day-to-day personal lives to improve that situation. But God has given us the ultimate source of joy, and it's there for everyone. They can't take our joy from us if our joy is in God's word, because God's word is everywhere. It's in the design of a tree, or the nuthatches that are right now eating from my bird feeder, you know, the way their feathers are designed so that they can fly. And it's given to us, expressed in words that we understand in God's word. Such a gift this song is, and so much wisdom this young man has, although his day-to-day lot has not really improved throughout the writing of this psalm. Well, thank you for joining me for another 5 good minutes. We're going to pick up with Mem, the letter M, tomorrow. Thank you for joining me.